Compañeros de la Sala Pública, bienvenidos a este nuestro cuarto seminario de esta serie especial que
Good morning, dear colleagues. This is the fourth seminar in this series organized by BAHO. It is really a pleasure to have you here with us. My name is Natalia Hodden. I am a specialist in monitoring, evolution, and analysis of health systems from OPS-OMS, and I will BAHO. And I will be the moderator of this very important event. As you are aware, our health systems in the Americas are very complex and involve several stakeholders, and the participation of the private sector is significantly important because of its size and the various roles the private sector performs in healthcare supplies and many other roles. And with a whole range of arrangements and schemes, which poses a challenge for health systems, our health authorities, and their governance, health system governance roles. For this reason, today we will be discussing from a technical and political viewpoint on a very special and important issue, and that's why we have called this seminar Regulation of the Private Sector in the Health System, with an emphasis on assurance, health insurance in the Americas. So that's going to be the focus of our debate today. We have a very important team of panelists, experts, who will be sharing their thoughts, their insights, and also our work as at the PHO and in countries that have a further along that way, like Chile, Colombia, and Jamaica. A couple of housekeeping announcements. We're going to have a simultaneous interpretation in the fourth official languages, English, Spanish, Portuguese, and French. So please feel free to choose the language of your preference. And to do that, click on the globe at icon at the bottom of your screen. We also have international sign interpretation that you will see throughout the entire activity. We have a short time that will be given to the various panelists. Please ask your questions and include your comments in the QA section at the bottom of your screen, Zoom screen. To start the seminar, I will now turn it over to the health of primary health systems and integrated health systems of the Pan-American Health Organization, for the Americas Regional Office of the World Health Organization, WHO. Dr. Ernesto Vasquez. Ernesto, over to you. Good morning, good afternoon to everybody. Please confirm that you can see my screen. Yes, perfectly. Please put it on presentation mode. Here we go. Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Greetings to everybody. I'm going to take just a couple of minutes for a very brief presentation and some backgrounds and the relevance of the private sector, and in particular, assurance, health insurance in our region. And when I talk about our region, I will say that today's webinar will focus on the situation in Latin America, and also some ideas at a very high level of our references that provide the analytical framework for the technical cooperation work that we perform at the BHHO. A couple of decades ago, when we talked about the participation of the private sector in the health assurance, that seemed to be totally marginal. It was an element that was not that would not constitute a critical, crucial element. And in terms of the health structures, or the reformer processes of health system. Decades later, however, even as part of the healthcare system processes that regional countries have gone through, the private health insurance sector has become a very important component. And here we're talking about a participation, a stake that is above 20% on average for the region. But if we focus on the countries that have carried out reform processes based on health, social security, the participation of the private sector administration of public research has exceeded 43%. This has a number of peculiarities depending on each country's specificities. When we're talking about a private sector in Chile, these are the ISAPRES. In Peru, these are the EPSs, and the prepaid systems in Argentina, where the public resources are used and managed from the social works, the ARSs in the Dominican Republic and EPSs in Colombia, and the mutual health insurance companies in Uruguay, that where they perform a very important role. And today, these are known as the IAHCs, which are, a matter of fact, organizations that play a critical role in managing resources from contributive funds. This has changed the characteristics of this system, where we used to describe the involvement of the private sector independently and parallel to the public system. And the matter of fact is that the reality is a lot more complex at present than what we see nowadays, is that the private sector includes a voluntary contributions. These are what we typically know as private resources, but also through the management of mandatory contributions. And this has created in our region a range of combinations, public-private mixes, combinations that have implications not only for insurance, but in the provision of public services, health services themselves. As you know, in the Americas, every time we address these very important issues that have to do with governance and the configuration, the transformation of a health system, we talk about the universal access, health access and coverage, and we're beyond the strategic areas, the four strategic areas that we talk about explicitly because of their relevance. We're talking here about a technical cooperation by the Pan American Health Organizations, but as a central axis of health services transformations in the various countries. I would like to highlight two fundamental elements. In the first place, the role that's played by governance, a cross-cutting role of governance, but of course, secondly, also how this has implications on the assurance, financing, funding models, and also the transformation or the setting up of the health services, healthcare services, and at the PHIO, and as a reference for our technical cooperation since 2014, and even in our own region, we have been working in many other through many other mandates. Like, for instance, more recently, the resilient healthcare system strategy, or the essential elements in public healthcare. In both cases, the cross-cutting regulatory elements in regards of financing and the provision of health services are particularly important when the private sector plays a fundamental role in those areas. At PHAO, we do not do this independently, but rather connected to important mandates and references at the World Health Organization. And on the right-hand side, above the dotted line, we have a very thickened agenda on regulatory areas, issues and the relationship with the private sector. In terms of the analytical framework, it is particularly important from our standpoint to mention the evaluation of performance of health systems. And as you see, once again, this is a key reference. Just last year, 2022, governance emerged as a defining, determining, configuring element for the rules of the game for all other health systems functions like creating resources and the preventing systems. And in this seminar, we're going to be addressing specifically to the financing issue, but also with other outcomes, intermediate outcomes, or more kind of like final outcomes. I would like to underscore something that is particularly relevant from a viewpoint and then has to do with access as a key component based on which we interpret not just the gaps, but also what are the outcomes, the results of the particular country's institutional setup issue. And we are going to focus on governance issues and the way they connect to all the other functions in these systems. And by this, I mean issues like policy and vision, and to assure the involvement and to assure the voice of the stakeholders, to the importance of intel in the health systems, and in particular case on legislation and regulatory components in the health systems, in particular as they regard the participation of the private sector. And as I mentioned just a moment ago, we will connect this to these four axes or components of the financing function that's like procurement and regulation of health carrier services. I'm going to quickly mention some prior work that PAHO has done to understand the gaps of one of the emerging structures in the last couple of decades, perhaps even a little bit earlier, and it has to do with superintendency, the regulatory agencies. What we see here is the year when they were created. These are regulatory agencies that in our particular cases are the superintendencies of health services or systems. And as you can see on this table, it's important to highlight the context in where these regulatory agencies appear. They are a consequence of the reform agenda in each of these countries. This is a listing of the creation of years and the context that provide us with the guidelines to understand that the regulatory agencies, in terms of their role, go at the same pace as the reform of health system. This table shows how these agencies actually operate and what is the scope of their work in terms of healthcare systems in regards of both the private and public systems. And we would like to highlight in particular that healthcare, social security, they cover a range of roles as a consequence of the design of the reform processes that I just mentioned. However, these agencies were not created without further changes and ratifications. And this is important because as the reforms evolve, and we do not think of these reforms as a snapshot, but rather as a processes that are a consequence of the challenges that emerge to address the people's health and needs, but also the institutional political setup in each of these countries. And here we wanted to highlight that many of the changes in the reform dynamics resulted in changes in regulatory mechanisms. This is something that I would love to underscore. Part of the stimulus of the need to revisit the scope and the tools and mechanisms for regulation also responded to the private sector's own dynamics, how markets evolved, and the need to create mechanisms that would address and then we take into account the capacity to regulate those stakeholders that were in charge of the regulatory side, but also the supply side of the health services. This is what allowed us to understand in terms of structure and players and outcomes, and that allowed us to recognize that over time there's been important progress in these regulatory agencies' performance, but also typically, and this is kind of a warning to direct our agenda, not only ours, but many other agendas that focus or that has as its core the perspective to provide a primary health care is to determine, identify the conditions for access to health care services. In some, although there's increasing regulatory structures and behaviors, one of the elements that where regulations are still weak is to include access issues as a key topic, key issue that will allow us to recognize the most important gaps when it comes to the operation of the performance of the private sector. Is such a very complex relationship between the participation of the private health sector in health care systems. And this is because we, as we have underscored in regional countries, there have been significant progress in terms of coverage and the conditions of coverage itself, particularly for the most vulnerable segments of the population. However, we still do not find relevant access improvements. And this is one of the key elements from our viewpoint, because the reason of being of these health services reforms is fundamental. And I wanted to conclude with some key takeaways and that have to do with the analysis of these very relevant reform processes in the last 2.5 decades. Many of these reforms resorted to Social Security as a platform for the reform of all health systems. Some of the countries that engage in this kind of initiative are the ones that I mentioned, and the changes in the regulatory frameworks for these regulatory agencies that in particular sought to identify market failures to guarantee that health markets would be competitive. And this was more or less the rationale that guided these reforms. But as I said earlier, these were successful in terms of expanded coverage, but not necessarily to date have they meant improvements in conditions to access the health system, but in terms rather of equity of access to health services. The Assurance, a component, it was a key, played a key role because several of these reforms combined in various schemes, contributions that erstwhile worked like simultaneously in parallel without articulation. And I mean by this, contributive contributions, voluntary contributions to health insurance, and that came basically that provided private healthcare funding. And one of the key elements when we mapped the governance and the governance challenges faced by health authorities of fundamental health, public health services. And although these agencies have created very important technical capacities over years and decades, one important difficulty is the relationship between these agencies and health authorities. These institutions were kind of decentralized and autonomous in their operation and their structure. And I would like to highlight some innovations resulting from these types of experiences to see what lessons we have learned and to improve our capacity to better understand these institutional, innovative institutional setups that are so important. In the first place, these changes that may be understood as instrumental changes or even sectoral changes have been part of a reconfiguration of the role, the regulatory role as relates to markets, and the regulation of private players that manage both private and public researches. Secondly, and I wanted to highlight what's been ongoing in recent years as part of the agenda to reform not just the regulatory schemes, but the regulatory framework for the private sector's involvement, and that's to move from a model that just regulates market failures to interpreting the need to address the health services model of organization. It would seem that we cannot escape this situation. That is the need that any regulatory mechanism should have at its score the transformation of the healthcare services organizations as a critical element, hub, not for transforming the conditions to access healthcare, and in particular, in equity conditions. When we scrutinize access barriers, we see that many of the countries for which we have systemized these kinds of experiences, although they have resulted in gradual reductions in out-of-pocket expenses, the success in reducing other access barriers are much less. I am certain that today we're going to look at it in particular in more detail for a couple of countries and perhaps even have with us comments from leading stakeholders in these reform processes. Thank you very much. And yes, that is certainly right. This panorama that you have shared with us, in particular the need to expand the regulatory proposals and the care model to improve access. And as you said, we will now to start to look into some case studies. And I would like to invite now our economist and colleague David DeBroad, who will be talking to us about some case studies in three cases, Chile, Colombia, and Jamaica. David, over to you.
David, debes a abrir el micrófono.
Sí,
Ah.
disculpe.
Y poner la
Claudia.
presentación en modo presentación.
Sí. Ahí me confirman si ya se está viendo
Está
completa.
perfecto, perfecto, gracias.
Bueno, buenos días. La presentación que voy a hacer aborda principalmente los temas que tienen que ver con seguros privados de salud en tres casos, que son Colombia, Chile y Jamaica, donde estamos realizando un trabajo de levantamiento de información desde la Oficina Regional de OPS. Solo una pincelada respecto del marco analítico. Parte de este marco
Just a
lo.
few words about the analytical framework about this, and I just wanted to make some positions about how this information was gathered, was put together. We're talking about the systems, health systems, and the graphs of presented by Dr. Vargas. And so we have to understand the paradigm of behavior and performance, and what we have to do is understand that the regulations in health for health services should be focused on the relationship between the actors, and this is expressed here on the left side, where we have the beneficiary population here. And then the financing schemes and the provision schemes and a series of relationships that are the object of the regulations. And the final expected result is to reach the intermediate and final goals. And on the study we have been carrying out in all three countries consisted in reviewing the literature available on web pages and the academic literature and some interviews with key actors. And this is something that is taking place right now. So these are preliminary results. I will speak about Colombia first. In the case of Colombia, here we can see the sources of the of resources of finance sources. And here, the private sector participates in prepaid expenditure, and also it also makes general use of contributions for Social Security. Social Security, in this case, transfers the funds to the private insurance. And to the privates here, in the second graph, I have a majority participation in what is voluntary insurance and also in mandatory insurance from the perspective of these data. And here you see a general view of the participation of private insurance. And here we see, first of all, this red part here, this red diagram, the diagram in red, and here you see the entities promoting health and contribution and the subsidies. In a fundamental view, this is the participation. This is a participation of the private sector here. If we put it together with all the expenses in the health sector, the private insurance providers are participating in about 59%, which is quite a high amount in terms of the persons affiliated. And for the rest, the financing, the privates are 82.6%. And there is another part that is not supervised by the National Health Superintendence. And here we see and this includes the supplementary plans, the prepaid accident insurance, the prepaid ambulance services, and other supplementary services offered by private insurance. And this is a higher participation, but it, well, it all goes together here. And the elements that are relevant to point out is that Colombia is a unitarian state and decentralized unitarian state. And it's the political and administrative division is used for the services and resources is used for or by the central government. And since in 2018, a decentralization has been taking place, and in 1997, some competences were already decentralized and devolved to the private regime. And then the providers, suppliers, are the sellers of services for these insurance services called EPS. And this structure created a strong segmentation between the subsidized and the contribution regime, with plans of benefits that were differentiated, but also the EPS that work for both regimes. Apart from that, there are special regimes for example, the train system, the armed forces, etc. Each one of these has levels of access to services that are quite different among themselves. And recently, a central fund was created as an administrative entity for health services. It's called ADRES. And this is an entity that essentially transfers the resources to each one of the systems. There is a subsidy, a clear subsidy, because EPS, that is especially the ones based on contributions, have other sources of public from the public sector to finance care if UPC is not sufficient. And basically here, the evolution in time is, it depends on a first period or is characterized by a first period where the reforms were designed and implemented and health is understood as a service, a public service, but is provided by the private sector. This is the public-private regime that is well known in the region. And from 2004 to 2015, a series of reforms were carried out. But during this period, there is also a decision made by the Constitutional Court that protects certain sectors and establishes that the health services have to be equivalent both in the private and the public sector. And regarding the recent literature after 2015, show clearly that in terms of results, the type of insurance a person has and the characteristics of that insurance will determine the results. And in general terms, there are serious problems of access, comprehensive access, especially in regions that are isolated, and also problems in terms of mortality rates and mortality rates because of the COVID pandemic. As I said, it's the National Superintendent of Health that supervises this system. And also the financial supervision is carried out by the Superintendency of Finances. In general,
The 10-year plan for public health establishes responsibilities for EPS and ARL, and they are considered in a sense as actors that work together. The results obtained, as we see here, is that there are some achievements in terms of universal health coverage and financial coverage, but it is deficient in comprehensive access. And there are areas where there is no offer of services because these people live in isolated territories. Regarding the use of public funds, there are no concrete mechanisms based on the surveys. There is still a lack of regulations for services. And for example, there is a scale of services, but in terms of the payments, there is a micro-assignation of payment. For example, in a retrospective manner, and it's not really regulated. And the services covered are transferred to EPS. In the case of Chile, the sources of finance by private insurance companies are also covering a large part of what is called prepaid services and also a part of social services, security services, because people can receive or can take can make use of the mandatory contributions to public health as part of their financing scheme for private insurance. And there are mandatory services or mandatory contributions and voluntary contributions and services. And this table shows you also the number of actors participating on regarding private insurance. There are so-called ESFLs that cover a different number of beneficiaries, and this represents about 16%, and in terms of resources it represents around 23% of this financing. At the second floor level, here we include the private insurance and also the work accidents insurance have a lower participation, but it has been growing during the past years in terms of affiliation and financing. In the case of Chile, as it is a unitary and decentralized state, there is no unity between the political administration or division and the administration of health services. Chile developed a sort of area of health called health services. This entity not always coincides with the regional division, and this causes certain administrative problems because the political division is not the same as the administrative division of the country. And since the 90s, or since the 80s, there was a decentralization that handed over the administration of health services to the municipalities. This continued during the 90s. And the expenses, pocket expenses in the case of Chile, these are quite high. Threshold is more than 10%, and it has increased both in the public and the private sector, and also in the mixed services. And there is also a segmentation of financing. The mandatory contributions operate as a subsidy for private insurance, and there is a sort of substitution. It's not a unified system. The situation in Chile, or the evolution of this, started in the 80s when the constitution defined that people can choose between state and private system, and there is a large expansion of private insurance, and especially after the financial crisis was over, until 1997, and then there is a reduction and stagnation after 2008, and the business model was changed again, and there is a sentence by the Constitutional Tribunal that establishes as non-constitutional these factor tables. And between 2011 and 2023, there are a series of failed attempts for structural reform. In 2021, there is an attempt of solving this crisis through a decision of the Supreme Court about the factor tables, and for the crimes for GES, general insurance. And there is also a business model that is quite questioned because of the selective approach and the discrimination of pre-existing diseases. These tables I go over very quickly, but they basically show that although the private insurance participates in a minor percentage in comparison with Colombia regarding the financing, it is strongly privatized in terms of service. For example, in these hospital beds, in medical attention, it is majority in private in its majority, although the public system has a greater number of resources. And the same can be seen here on the part of financing, where the private insurers receives a series of purchases made through the public system. In Chile, the participation of privates is not included in the terms of the research carried out, and the regulation allows to choose private insurance and have the sort of last instance public insurance. And there are a series of subsidies without regulations about how to use them. So although the results are satisfactory in general terms, the regulations are deficient in terms of the financing that is very, very different on the public and private side. And recently, the situation has been difficult also for private insurance because there is a lack of incentives. And it is not focused enough on the primary health care. And you still have 5 minutes. And finally, the case of Jamaica. In the case of Jamaica, the resources used come from private insurance for prepaid services or still prepaid expense and social contributions. And in general, these are voluntary private insurance. They do not cooperate in terms of mandatory insurance, but there are some issues where private insurance is the main insurance. And there were four regions created here. There is a predominant scheme based on general taxes, and the services are provided through public suppliers without co-payment. And there's private insurance mainly for the highest income, highest fifth of income of the population. And there are two programs for public servants that can take part of the social contribution for this, for the payment of a substitution private insurance ambulatory services. And so there is a coverage of 50% of private insurance, and the rest is through co-payment. And the private industry, there are three main insurance companies that have open enrollment and are based on profit. There are regulations for private insurance through an authority, a regulatory authority, and based on the Insurance Act of Jamaica of 1965. There is a vertical integration, although regulations are not clear. There is also duplicity because those that use private insurance also use public insurance services. There is a retrospective payment to suppliers without previous agreements on terms. And there is a lack of knowledge by the authorities about how these services work. And the National Development Plan of up to 2030 does not include explicitly the participation of private insurance. And in terms of results, the legal framework for private insurance has not been updated. There are no effective incentives for the insured persons. And although this is established in regulations, and there is also a substitution scheme for a public servant that makes the public servants participate, but the regulation is not very clear. And the private insurance companies that operate on the local market have a wide coverage. This is the third case, and our main messages are the following. First of all, this study was carried out and is still being carried out of the analysis of private insurance, integrating several elements. And the second message is that sanitary planning should recognize the existence of private health schemes, and so that these are established for private agents also, and there are different studies that show that the presence or the absence or bad regulation of private health insurance are associated with problems in comprehensive access, and especially the equitative services, the equitative access to services. And this is the last slide. The three cases submitted are structurally very different. In Colombia, the presence of private insurance in mandatory regimes is quite generalized. It also administers a large part of public financing. In Chile, private insurance, mandatory private insurance, is only for a certain percentage of the population, and it has a lower part of contributions of subsidies, and it is possible to rely on voluntary contribution. In Jamaica, it is concentrated in supplementary insurance, but public servants can use them as substitute for National Health Service in ambulatory care. And in the case of, in some cases in Colombia and Chile, the legal framework is inadequate. In the case of Jamaica, there is also a concern about financial sustainability, because especially in non-transmittable diseases. And in the cases of Colombia and Chile, among the political priorities and government programs, it is difficult to focus on to carry out the necessary steps to transform or to reform health systems. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that presentation, and thanks very much for the overwhelming activity participants that have joined us, and also those who have joined us on the YouTube platform. Thanks very much for your participation, and I invite you to continue in this exchange among yourselves in the chat box. It is actually very active, and thanks very much for that. But this invitation would not be complete if we could not also have opportunity to hear to the countries that are leading, these countries that are basically the focus of the study that have led this process, Colombia, Chile, and Jamaica. As David mentioned, so we're going to now open the webinar to a team of the panelists who will be sharing with us their perceptions about the present challenges that have to do with the regulation, the authorities' role, and the future lines of work. I would now like to invite Margarita Escudero Osorio, who is a head for the in health insurance and labor, occupational health, and pensions of the Colombian Ministry of Social Protection. Over to you, Dr. Escudero, for your participation. Thanks very much, Natalia. Good morning, everybody. It is really a pleasure to be here with you on this webinar. And pursuant to the invitation that we have been given, I would be talking a little bit of the presentation that made by Dr. David and Dr. Bascalo. So from the standpoint of the Colombian health system, you are aware, certainly, that we are employing a system reform project, a proposal that has been sent to the Colombian Congress. It's already been sent to the Chamber of Representatives. It's going through its second round of debate, and then it'll be sent to the Senate. We expected that the project, the draft, will be approved with the corresponding adjustments made by the Colombian Congress. And there are enough strong reasons to understand why we want to reform the system. It is clear that although Colombia made a wager to assure greater coverage by health insurance, our coverage is above 98%. But this is not coherent with actual access to health services. we realize that there is increasing complaints before the health regulatory agency from the citizens to exercise their right, and that this points to the fact that there is no good access to health services. There is much inequality among the people. There are cities and municipalities where the service supplies is very good, but there are others that are completely devoid of a service supply. One of the transparencies that's shown to us by Dr. David, it was a scene that insurance companies were not forced to guarantee access in the areas where they operate. So there are areas where there is no single health service and nobody has made the necessary investment. So what we have proposed is that the Colombian state will recover the governance of the system as it should have always been, and to act as a guarantor that those remote and vulnerable municipalities will be provided with its health services, so that people there would be able, would have access to minimum health services to which we all have a right. And also, we want to better the fact that health should not be a market governed by market, but rather to be understood as a right for everybody to have access to such a health service based on a primary health care without that depending on whether I contribute or not, or what type of a contribution is made, that should all have equal access regardless of our capacity to pay. And this is what the government wants to assure. Resources are there, and they have been given to health providers, but unfortunately, these organizations were more concerned with their business sustainability rather than guaranteeing people's rights. So we want, we aim at correcting that situation so that resources would actually be invested in the healthcare, and that the healthcare providers will be paid directly without having financial intermediaries, and which has led to the inappropriate use of those resources. Another important thing that was mentioned in Colombia and also in other countries is that the complementary health plans have become mechanisms to capture resources. You pay for a complementary resource, but actually the question is whether the services that are included in the benefits plan that is regulated by law is actually provided. But at the end of the day, they become the charge for additional premises to premiums to assure the supply of services, health services that should actually be provided by the system. So to have a timely service, you end up by paying additionally to what the system should provide automatically. So there is a recognition that the Colombian health system has failed in the way that it was initially conceived to operate. But 30 years down the road, we have realized that there are significant failures in access and to guarantee the right to health to which we all have I wonder if there are any questions or comments. Thanks very much for your comments, and thanks also very much for bringing to our attention the need to recover the health authorities governance role, which is precisely what is being sought by the Colombian reform process, so that we can make the access to health and reality. The chat box is open for your participation and interaction. And thank you very much for your comments and remarks. And now I would like to invite Dr. Victor Torres. Victor Torres is the Chilean health superintendent. And we would appreciate very much your comments and remarks. Dr. Torres, where are you? Thanks very much, Natalie. Can you hear me well? Very well. I also want to send my regards to you, to the group, and Dr. Bascala. And I thank him for their very interesting presentation. I would like to comment about a couple of things, particularly from the viewpoint of the regulatory agencies like the superintendents that I have the honor of governing in Chile, in particular when it comes to the understanding that the role of the CPNN is to guarantee the people's right efficiently and with equality through our monitoring and surveillance of these organizations. That means that the CPNN should have the effective capacity to oversee private and public securities and their managers, and that is where we find an important deficiency when we look at the overall system, because we have a certain constraints and deficiencies to comply with these rules. However, it is important to look at all this from the viewpoint that you have adopted that has to do with a private insurance company. What is happening in our own particular case in Chile? If we do not necessarily take into account the decisions by the Supreme Court that has had important consequences. In addition to being private organizations, they should be taken into consideration as a hills of public services. In Chile, they are basically governed by market regulations, or rules rather, like fee for services. And where the has led the prices to go up, to rise, and with the transmission of our cost to our prices, if we add to that the Chilean health system shows that there is all the potential, like I said, like agencing and asymmetries and induction to demand. This deepens the inequality of access. It creates a greater selection, particularly based on people's payment selection. And in recent times, it has also led to the reduction in the number of system beneficiaries. Dr. Broad mentioned a population of Zapres, about 3 million people, that is the population to end December 21, that already revealed that there was a significant reduction in the number of beneficiaries. To September, the figure had dropped to 2.8 million. So between January and February, the number of beneficiaries has dropped by 150,000, including new contracts and the people that have left the system. And this responds basically to what we just discussed, the increases that result in a higher cost for the users, and that has led to a contraction of the system and greater difficulty for access to people, because most of these people end up in the FONASA system, and in other cases, they lose, although this is a small number, an insurance system. Although this is not a very significant case, Chile faces a significant challenge, and I was leaving aside the constitutional court decisions, because even if they did not see the structural system of the private health system in Chile would have an impact, and as has happened, and I just mentioned, because of a mandatory contribution, as David said, that are not part of the accumulated public resources, and in some cases they result in a surplus amounts that are not equally distributed. These resources that oftentimes are returned by way of services are health services or in cash. People are, this is tax-free money, so there is no contribution to what would make the system a lot more efficient. Clearly, also, there's weak incentives, particularly when it comes to the APSs, as David just mentioned, but also when it comes to cost containment. In other words, how can we, for instance, change the existing payment mechanisms of the private sector where there is no GRD systems, there is no results-driven payments, so clearly this is something that this is part of the challenges that Chile faces if we are going to keep in place the private health system. A reform may make us should be guided by a consideration of the type of system that should be put in place in the system, whether, as some say, we should have a multi-insurance system or a national insurance system, a complementary insurance system, etc. This is part of the debate, but clearly, any which system which is, will not be a sustainable over time if there is no cost containment mechanisms, like I just mentioned. And Chile has accepted clearly that the public insurance that uses these kinds of tools, and that has led to a reduction of payments and contributions in a significant amount in recent times. To wrap up with some of these remarks, I wonder how much time is left. From our viewpoint, as a regulatory agency in Chile, it is important to and ourselves with a greater powers that can oversee the things that I just mentioned and intervene, for instance, when it comes to contracts between private managers and private health providers, because when the contract ends, the patient suffers the consequences with any kind of compensation. And so it is important that we have a greater powers to monitor and surveil the relationship between public and private providers, and also to be able to oversee the public providers and health providers. This is kind of difficult today, because to do that, we have a certain constraints from the viewpoint of our attributions and powers, and also researchers, as in many other countries, and the possibility also to arbitrate on a conflict resolution. We do have on the side of the insurance company, but not health providers, and the scope of a mandatory and voluntary insurance, because there is a whole world of private health providers that are not supervised by our agency, but rather by the financial regulator. And that's an important consideration when it comes to the debate of the ISAPRE law, that is a draft law that is being debated, but also the possibility of putting in place a new model that might eventually put in place in countries. So, this is a very general number of comments to contribute to what David just discussed. Thanks very much, Torres, for the presentations. And there are many, many remarks and comments in the chat, and we will continue debating through the questions and remarks in the chat. And thanks very much for the your message on the importance of strengthening the regulatory agents, like the health superintendents in Chile, and of strengthening their capacity for following up and a mantra. And we had considered the possibility of having just barely the financial enemies for data science at the Jamaican Ministry of Health, and but because of other commitments, he will not be joining us in this panel. And I also wanted to announce that the presentations and the materials for this webinar will be available in the webpage on the primary health services. This has been also, the access links has also been posted in the chat box. So I encourage you to follow the links that are posted there, and also the other presentations that we have shared in this event. This presentation, this event would not be complete. We could not take a regional overview and also to other countries in terms of the participation of the private sector and the efforts that are made to regulate these private players. And that is why we also have with us today our colleagues from Brazil and experts in this field. They include Dr. Cariari, that is a specialist in supplementary health services from the Supplementary Health Services Agencies. And also, we'll have the honor of having with us Dr. Satrangelo, who is also an expert in this issue, and he's a senior researcher at the University of Buenos Aires in this respect in the economic sciences department. I would like to now turn over to Dr. Adi from the National Supplementary Health Agency, shares with us her remarks. Welcome, Dr. Audi.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I thank you on behalf of the agency for the opportunity of being here with you, telling you about the specific situation we find in Brazil. When we speak about Brazil, we must first of all think about its size, its population, 206 million users. 206 million Brazilians use this service. Before I start speaking about the public and private sectors, I cannot refrain from speaking about the huge challenge for all of the healthcare systems that we have gone through, which is aging populations and an increase in chronic non-transmissible diseases. This is an enormous challenge for all of the healthcare systems. Here in Brazil, as most of us are aware, we do have a very strong public sector, SUS, the single healthcare system in Brazil, which was created in the federal constitution. It brings forth universality, integrality, and equity. And the citizens that are under coverage of the SUS universality concept, well, even the people who use the private sector, they are also under the care of SUS. SUS is responsible for 3/4 of healthcare for the Brazilian population as a whole. There is no direct contribution to SUS. And SUS also holds prevention campaigns, educational campaign. The ministry has very surveys going on to find out the health-related needs of the Brazilian populations. And the system is also not linked to any type of work relation. It is a right of every Brazilian citizen. This is guaranteed in our constitution. The constitution clearly says health is the right of all and a duty of the state. Law 9656 was drafted in 1988 to regulate a system that had been hitherto working without any specific regulation. It brought the population and the operators and the providers rights and duties. So there are rights for those who use these services. The type of procedures, health-related procedures, were defined. The duties were defined. These procedures should cover all of the diseases that were stated in CID 10. So this list of procedures that are covered is always updated and show us the evolving needs of such coverage. It's important to speak about this because when you have larger coverages, healthcare assistance coverage, the need of evidence-based processes and regulated processes are obvious. So the National Regulatory Agency for Private Health Insurance has a mandate to defend these users in health, in meeting their healthcare needs. So our agency regulates the private health provider and works with both the private providers and the users with a view to improving healthcare in our country. This is very important because the policies that are determined by the Ministry of Health, they give the agency a way forward. And there is a legal basis that seeks to improve these users to ensure that their voices are heard when they choose their healthcare providers and their and meeting their needs. So when we're trying to improve these consumers' hypo-sufficiency and their needs, it beams a light on an activity which in a certain sense relieves pressure on the public healthcare system. I wanted now to tell you about a summary of our legislation. I don't know if you're familiar with this legislation. So this legislation increases in standardizing the roles of these supplementary health care coverage. It also puts forth rules that regulate patients with pre-existing health problems before hiring the service. That is, the patient needs to be aware of the disease. So this really helps us manage situations such as fraud. There's also a control in pricing regulations. There are requisites in terms of capital and parameters for sustainability and technical aspects of these providers. Transparency is a mandate. The financial status, the 9656 law bill mandates that. So the providers are under obligation to send the ANS several informations on an ongoing basis. If a certain provider is undergoing financial problems, for example, it can reach out and be supported in terms of financial operation, of technical operation. So the law gives us all of these resources so we can ensure that the customer of these healthcare plans are duly cared for. We also have a diversity, a very important diversity in terms of our complementary health modalities. We have five types of medical hospital providers. We have philanthropic agencies, cooperative, medical cooperative, group medical operators, dental care operators, and we also have providers that give the customer the opportunity of a combined dental health care plan. So the consumer can consider, well, in 70% of customers of private health care plans in Brazil are part of collective plans or institutional collective plans. That is, the customer is someone who works for a given company. This is an important difference because we're not only dealing with firms, with businesses, but with people. There is an enormous number of healthcare operators who work with these providers. So there is an amalgamation of these factors, and we also have other types of plans who work in the area. It's very important to say a bit about the numbers. I'll give you some data from 2022. For example, the income for medical hospital providers was approximately 167 billion reais compared to the cost they incurred, which was 157 billion, which means a rate of 89.3% of difference. When we look at dental plans, operators that work only with dental plans, the income in 2022 was 207 billion and the costs were 1.1 billion, the difference being 41.8%. So we can see that there, it is a very complex operation for a dental plan and for a medical and hospital plans. They are very different amongst themselves. We have very large challenges ahead when we look at this, what is being done, when we look at the type of assistance that is being given. We still have a type of payment system is paid on procedures. We also have to look at an aging population and an increase of chronic diseases. This increases costs, out-of-pocket costs for the patients, and the technology increases these costs as well. And we also have a type of uncoordinated care when there are no pre-existence lines of care. We do not have primary health care in this field of private health. This is something that we're delving into right now in certification of these providers. But the network is fragmented, the care is fragmented. There is no single central coordinator for this private health care. And this is very important for this sector. Now, in terms of evaluating healthcare quality, how do you measure this? How can you put forth indexes, indicators, which show us a clear need for improvement? So we can see that there is a rising healthcare costs, and we also have another problem, which always is very important, which is the absence, as we said. There is no consolidated primary health care in the private sector, and there is an absence of investment in prevention, that is promotion of health care and disease prevention. So looking at these users' lifestyle and their habits and the risks they bring. So in a large segment of the population is overweight, is sedentary, and this runs into obesity, and that is not something that is prevented, because when the provider starts dealing with this issue, it is already at the stage of disease, of heart failure, etc. So this an epidemic, for example, is seen at a later point. When the patient comes to us, this, for example, the epidemic of obesity, the patient is already at a type 2 diabetes, liver failure. So we need to coordinate this work, look at the attributes, the longitudinal segments, the import of access and accessibility. Our agency's board of directors has a special board for sectoral development that evaluates and induces quality in the private healthcare sector. Several programs are in place to foster quality, to create indicators, and to improve the sector as a whole. There is a program for qualifying these providers, which evaluates all of the providers according to their to how well they do in caring for their users. There is an accreditation system for these providers, and we also have processes for certification. Certification in primary health care, for example, 5 providers are currently certified, and 15 providers are currently preparing for the certification. They are part of a project called Integral Healthcare. A new project was opened for a new cycle to select these providers, so a new batch of providers would start preparing for certification. We also have a special certification in terms of certification for childbirth, that starts off during pregnancy and runs all the way till the first years of this child's life. There is also a project which was affected a few years ago to assess care for oncologic students. I'm sorry, can you hear me? We have a program that looks at the quality for hospitals, and our agency has data on that. And we have promotion and provincial programs, which tries to show operators the need for them to act as healthcare managers so they can organize, they can improve the healthcare for their users. I don't know if I was, if I had enough time to say everything I needed, but I am at your disposal to answer any questions.
Compañeros tienen problemas de conexión. Nada más aclarar que creo que se trata de la conexión de ustedes en casa. Quizás nosotros estamos escuchando sin.
Thank you very much, Dr. Adi. We can hear the presentations perfectly well. There may be some connection issues, and this is a conversation, so there will be no presentations during this segment. Now I have the honor of turning over to Dr. Sitrangala. As I mentioned earlier, Dr. Sitrangala is a senior professor at the University of Buenos Aires and CONICET. Over to you, Dr. Sitrangala. Can you hear me well? Yes, perfectly well. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Natalia and Juan Pablo, for the invitation. These have been a very interesting presentations and comments. I think when to talk directly about the issues, because there is not much time, when you're talking about regulatory issues, you cannot look at them in isolation in each country's health system. I think that one of the great merits of your work is that you have provided a context for the regulation of the private sector, and not just the other systems, but also the history, how each country has reached where they are. Another meritorious thing is that we have started with the three countries that have a very different system, a system that is basically financed from contributions, mandatory contributions, although my attention was drawn by the fact that Jamaica system leaves government workers outside of the system. That would require a study in itself. This is a system that has insisted on reforming it, but does not solve the access problem like in Colombia. Of course, they face issues because of the large territory, like in Brazil and in Chile. Both in the presentation and the comments by Dr. Torres, it is clear that a pending issue for the region from the viewpoint of Argentina is the use of social security, health social security resources to finance private coverage, which is another of the issues that have been discussed. I think these are all challenges in a situation that perhaps we should separate the purely regulatory issues, which is kind of difficult when it comes to the facts on the ground, like, for instance, the various types of contracts and payment systems in the private sector that can be a provider of social security or directly a health provider, or even there are several ways in which this system is set up, and that requires different types of regulation, but basically they all boil down to the design of each particular case. In the Colombian and Chilean cases, the difficulties were mentioned for the private sector to become involved in providing universal, equitable access to health coverage. We should be able to differentiate what issues are within the regulatory, the general policy and the regulation of the private sector. The private providers are comprised within this general policy in one way. So this is an area where we should be focusing our attention and our work. We have seen these three cases plus Brazil, but clearly differently would happen 10 years ago. It is hard to have a full typology of cases in Latin America. The cases that we thought were like models have been evolving, and they have required new changes to address the new domestic. And now it's hard to have this typology. This is something that we have to work on, we have to focus our attention on, and if there's been progress in some cases, those will show very different things and open a range of possibilities. So it is important from my viewpoint to recognize the differences between the countries and the differences with cases and where they are headed. There are cases like we thought where we assumed that they had addressed a fragmentation issue, some rights fragmentation issues, like Costa Rica as an example, or was another. We may wonder if they were still on that track. Brazil, at a point in time, appeared as equitable universal access model, but it has its own issues. Well, I think that we should be looking at the regulatory side, and there the information asymmetry and windfall rent seeking in the private sector is going to add a difficulty to the regulations, and we need a very strong technical teams that, and to the extent possible, as independent as possible from power groups in the health sector, which are very important because this is a sector where 8-9% of GDP is spent in sectors that are very hard to regulate. So I think, and to sum it up, when we do these kinds of studies, we can thereby reformulate the old concepts and face the rising challenges and see how private sector regulations can be a match to other types of policies that will allow to put in place a universal access, and as clearly, more clear in Colombia than in the cases, universal access that are not always paid the attention they deserve. Thank you very much, Dr. Cetrangla, for your comments, and certainly the invitation to continue with this work at our organization. And from the standpoint, I would like to turn over to economist Juan Pablo Pagano, who is a specialist in the health financing, and will be talking to us about the future lines of work and our future activities in this regard. Over to you, Juan Pablo, and thanks very much for those words, Natalia, and thanks for the other participants. We are aware that we're running a little bit behind, and I'll only take 5 minutes. In the first place, I would like to identify some of the regulatory challenges that are shared by many countries, in particular the three countries where we have aimed at characterizing, but that are also applicable to many Latin American and Caribbean countries. So there are 4 bullets, just 10 seconds each. Don't worry, Natalia. In all cases, would we realize that these private providers, we are basically paying attention to the assurance side, not necessarily the supply side, health supply side, healthcare supply side, but and these agents operate formally within the health social security, or other times kind of informally through a pseudo healthcare systems. Like for instance, in Brazil, these are provided as a part of a worker benefit package. Although they are not formal health social security packages, they are a sort of a pseudo a social health security as part of the benefit packages. And that's an important component of the system. And therefore, they have to be regulated because they have to be treated as part of the need to regulate the labor market. Secondly, beyond the more like a macro or meso level mechanisms, the relationship between the insurers and the providers is an important component of a back pay, the fee-for-service kind of a scheme. And the other countries that we have not examined in this webinar is also share this kind of a scheme, and also the challenge to create payment mechanisms that are like are not necessarily compressed in the fee for service, because that implies a number of issues. The national health authorities and the regulatory agencies and the superintendencies want to look at this, but they face a number of specific complications because they go beyond the mechanisms that are used to distribute the resources. It is like a second layer of research allocation. And in the thirdly, in all cases, the involvement of in terms of the inequalities of access to service, these schemes are sort of amplifying them, this participation of a private sector, rather than bring us closer to equality and access to private sector, rather creates a new segmentation layer, or different conditions of access depending on the kind of health system, healthcare system, these segments of population belong in. In the fourth place, specifically regarding the work that we, this is the primary health services unit at BAHO, the role, we see that the role of private health care providers generally does not create strong incentives to expand the provision of healthcare in terms of a primary healthcare, but also the operation of these markets create very weak incentives because of the to strengthen the primary healthcare in a primary level, as has been discussed by our colleagues from various countries. So why do we want to identify these mechanisms? Because in our role as a technical cooperation agency, we want to help the countries to overcome, meet these challenges, and create policies that will aid countries in this respect. So OPS does a lot of technical work, in particular our unit, and when it comes to financing, generally we contribute and support in many countries the mechanisms to address financing issues from a comprehensive viewpoint, but also particularly in helping design resource allocation mechanisms that reflect the specific territory and health systems. The mechanisms. So there we provide important support and contributed to design these payment mechanisms. When it comes in particular to prices issues, we are reviewing the experience of various countries tariff setting handbooks and their drafting, because there is a significant regulation of payments that are done in the health system. Also, we support the distribution of resources through the national health accounts so that we can more precisely track where resources are used in the health system. And also, we engage in financial protection and monitoring mechanisms. In other words, what is happening with households that have access to these insurance and that have to, and there we have to think in terms of out-of-pocket payments as a barrier to access health services. Another issue has to do with national health authorities skill building to effectively regulate these actors as part of the new essential public services. We do a lot of very intense work in the regarding the new essential health provision of services that require a integrated approach for these systems, national systems. So this approach, a staggered approach, and in particular the second stage in determining the capacity of health authorities to perform in this governance functions. And thirdly, gap analysis in several countries to strengthen their capacities, also in the same framework of work. Same framework, we have engaged in a number of in-depth country studies to determine access barriers leading to a plan that would allow those countries to overcome this. And this is not just a financial and economic, but there are also other barriers that have to do with the insurance and mechanisms that reinforce those barriers. And then finally, when it comes to the supply and organization of our health services, there are several lines of work, areas of work in several countries. In our department, we are working on an action plan to improve health services quality throughout the Americas that comprises several lines of work that are particularly related to a service supplied not only but through the assurance to prepare specific indicators to determine the those service supplies. This is very important, the capacity, resolution capacity, in the understanding that these assurance mechanisms do not have sufficient incentives to strengthen those capacities, but rather reduce them. So we're doing a lot of work with member countries in this regard, and specifically when it comes to national health services and the costs behind that, that has to do with creating these tariff handbooks and the costs that are paid. We help countries in creating cost account information system for the various health services and in monitoring cost resource allocation, and in particular when it comes to prevention services that can strengthen allocation mechanisms within a health system to increase the equality and resource allocation and their use. This is a bird's eye view of the various areas of work, and but I would like to underscore that all our member countries have the support of our organization, the Pan American Health Organization, to assist them in their endeavors. Thanks very much, Pablo. And before we close, I would like to once again invite you, our colleagues, to our next webinar on November 21st, when we will be discussing a traditional medicine and complementary medicine and primary health service in the Americas. So welcome, dear colleagues, and thanks very much for your participation today. We have taken a little bit more time than our original plan, but I'm certain that this proved to be very interesting for you. And thank you very much to our distinguished panelists for joining us in this work day. Have a great afternoon, and see you November 21st.
luego, que esté muy bien.
Muchísimas gracias.
Ah, boa tarde a todos.